will be rain, snow, cold, warm, any weather basically, as long as it's safe and we can get out here, we will visit here every week to do all our maintenance and all our things that we need to do. So a lot of good clothes, and always bring your rain jacket. It's usually a good thing. Lots of good snacks, so you keep your energy up and don't get hangry.
The Malaise Trap was invented by René Malaise, he was a Swedish entomologist, and he noticed that when he went camping, the insects always ended up at the top of his tent. And so he thought it might be a good way to catch them. So he designed this sort of tent where insects would fly in from here or on the other side, and then they fly up into here. And at the top we have a trap and a bottle with ethanol, and so they fly up and they fall into the ethanol. And so after a week we get a bottle of essentially insect soup. So it's mostly flying insects, so it's a lot of flies, some bees, some wasps, occasionally some non-flying insects, but it is mostly flying insects. And what we do with this is that we send it to Canada and they do DNA sequencing and they can find out what the different species are.
These are our camera traps. They are actually specifically made for this project. It's a motion sensor, and it will, as soon as something walks by basically that has a different temperature from the environment or the ambient temperature, it will trigger the camera and it will take a series of 5 pictures from it to see. Hopefully we'll get a lot of mammals. It's mostly ground living mammals that we're focusing on, but it will hopefully catch some birds and maybe some insects and whatever else. So we deploy them at about 50 centimeters from the ground, because then we can catch very small mammals up to size of moose or like really big one, elephants, because big animals you can usually identify even from their legs. We're doing way more sites in Sweden and Madagascar than the rest of the world. Most sites have one or two plot, one urban and one natural. And we will have natural sites. Our team is responsible for 28 sites in this sampling design of different scales to see how processes work at different like distances and scales. And they will have the same in Madagascar. And then we have people collaborating with us here in Sweden to do national sites all over Sweden. And in Madagascar, they are also doing 25 national sites, I think. Yeah. With this project, it's a lot of data. So we're probably gonna find new species unknown to science. And it's just really cool to be out here and experience that, be part of it. Because without the people on the ground, without us and all the people we work with and everyone around the world, if not for them, there wouldn't be any data to work with. So it's really exciting.
I'm going to take soil sample using a spoon. First of all, I remove the surface since it's full of weed leaves and roots and all kind of things. Super gloves, because it's pretty important to keep your hands clean and like I try to dig down 5 centimeter deep, because we think we would find most of the fungi in this area close to the surface, and they are more active here. So yeah, here is the sample. As you can see, it's full of weed roots and small tree pieces, and the goal is to remove all of these big parts. Yeah, so we will get these pouches from all over the world, and after grinding the homogenizing the samples, we will extract DNA, and after lab work, PCRs and all kind of things, we will sequence them, and then it will turn out what kind of fungal community we have.
So these are our audio recorders that will record bird sounds and also bat sounds and basically anything else. We're mostly focusing on birds, but it will collect amphibians, insects that we hope to be able to identify. So it's in these protective casings and the actual recorder. Let's see if I can open this. Looks like this. So these will maintain every week to change the batteries and the SD cards, because they will generate a lot of data. So we have these pretty big 64 gigabyte SD cards, and we estimate that they will last about a week before they're completely full. So we will be using rechargeable batteries, because there's such a huge amount of batteries in this project that we don't want to use normal, like non-rechargeable ones. So it's an extra step, but for the environment's sake, for the global project, it will be thousands and thousands of batteries. And if we need to switch them out every week, it's just, we don't want to do that to our planet. Oh no. Okay. Managed to unclip this. Part of field work, things fall off and break and you need to improvise. There we go. And these are deployed about approximately 2 meters up in the same tree as we have our camera traps. The SD cards we bring back with us to the university, or people will bring them back to where they're stationed, and then the data will be uploaded to servers in Helsinki, and from there people will process this data with the specialized programs and AIs that we will use to go through all the audio recordings and data. And we will also get help from a lot of bird enthusiasts all over the world, who helps us identify bird sounds so the AI can actually learn from them.
So this is a cyclone sampler. It has a little pump in there, and it sucks in the air around it, and it catches pollen and spores, and specifically we're looking at fungal spores. And so we leave this out for 24 hours. We have a little tube in there, and we collect this tube, and then we can analyze the DNA that is present in this tube to find out how many species of fungal spores and also some pollen are, how many are present in our site. This will go to the lab, and we will clean them and dry them, and then we will send them to Guelph University for analysis. And so because we have so many sites, we have designed an app. so that instead of everyone writing down things on paper that can be lost, we can actually have it all on the phone and then it gets sent to us, which is very practical.
Yeah, so for the data collection, there will always be errors that happens, both because of humans, like me or my colleagues, because that's just the way it is. You could forget to scan something, or that then the app will tell you, but you can scan the wrong SD cards for the wrong camera. You can forget to charge batteries. There's a lot of things that can happen because it's a lot of work and it's a lot of long hours, so human errors will happen. But also, no matter how careful you are or how hard you try, there will be errors that happen, and you might have to discard sample because of things you can't predict or you can't control. So for the cyclone tubes, for example, when the sampler runs, there will be instances where you have the whole tube might fill up with water and just wash everything out because it's just so much rain. It might be a lot of insects in there that could affect the data, and there's just a lot of things that can go wrong. The lenses on the camera traps can get really foggy if it's foggy out. Even if you treat that with like anti-fog spray or things, you could have pictures that just won't end up with anything on it except white or black, and things malfunction. So it's important to remember that there are errors that's going to happen no matter how careful you are. So the errors in the data might be either someone making a mistake or nature doing its thing, basically.